Okay, let's go ahead and get started. Good morning. Welcome to Thursday at RSA. My name's Randy Trzeciak. I'm from Carnegie Mellon University, the Software Engineering Institute, the CERT division. We're here to talk to you today about a framework to effectively develop insider threat controls. So the way we do this presentation this morning is that we're going to go through the material. We will reserve some time at the end for questions and answers. And if there are still unanswered questions at the end of this session, we do have a booth 1538 in Moscone South. I will be there from about 10 until 12 today. Happy to have you stop by or reach out to us after the conference to answer any questions that you do have. So I'll begin by introducing myself. As I said, Randy Trzeciak. I'm the director of the National Insider Threat Center at Carnegie Mellon University. Our group is responsible for researching cybersecurity in relation to insider threats. I do want to make sure you have available resources to you. So if you do happen to stumble upon our website, the CERT division of the Software Engineering Institute at Carnegie Mellon, you will find over 100 reports related to insider threats, as well as other material in terms of blogs, technical notes, technical reports, and other white papers that are available there. In addition to being the lead of the insider threat body of work in the CERT division, I'm the program director for the Masters of Science in Information Security at Carnegie Mellon University. And the reason I offer that up is that if you are looking for master's degree interns in cybersecurity, if you're looking to do group work in terms of project work with students, or if you're looking to recruit some of our students, happy to begin a dialogue with you as well. So with that, I'd like to introduce Dan Costa as part of my team to introduce himself, and then we will get on with the slides and the overview of the material.
Thanks, Randy. Good morning, everybody. My name is Dan Costa. I'm the technical solutions team lead for the CERT National Insider Threat Center, the Carnegie Mellon Software Engineering Institute. Long title. My business card is big. As a part of my role and responsibility within the CERT National Insider Threat Center, I oversee our insider incident data collection and analysis process. So we use empirical data to establish patterns of activity that have occurred in malicious and unintentional insider incidents. We try to learn what vulnerabilities existed within organizations that enabled insiders to carry out their attacks, and what are the opportunities to deploy controls that we can use to prevent, detect, respond, recover, deter those concerning behaviors and activity from happening within your own organizations. So we spend lots of time thinking about how to develop, how to deploy, how to configure controls, ways to collect and analyze data across an organization to help the organization gain a clearer picture of insider risk. So we'll be presenting today some of the work that we've done over the years in figuring out the most effective ways to identify and navigate that insider threat control landscape.
Okay. Thanks, Dan. So what we're going to do in terms of the materials, go through the slides. We'll reserve enough time towards the end for questions, so feel free to hold your questions to the end. Just as a reminder, the slides are available on the RSA website. They are actually recording the audio with this, and they will sync them up with the slides just to make sure you have the material to go. And with that said, you're certainly welcome to take pictures of the slides, but it might be better quality from a visual aspect to actually use the slides that will be available on the website itself. So what we want to basically do is to use a number of incidents to demonstrate the types of insider incidents. As we look into the title of the presentation, looking for a framework to develop controls, we want to identify what are we trying to control. Obviously, from an insider threat perspective, it's an authorized individual, in many cases doing an authorized thing, but some of those individuals have malicious intent. Are there ways by which you can develop detective controls, preventative controls, administrative controls, compensating controls to be able to prevent or detect malicious activity as early as possible to minimize the impact to your organization? So as Dan described, we've collected incidents going back to 1996 to the present where an insider caused harm. From that, we try to develop those models, those patterns of activity as a way to assist in the development of potential risk indicator, both behaviorally based indicators and technically based indicators. So one of the cases is where somebody, an insider, was demoted. He was a software engineer, stole over $1 billion worth of technology and goes to work for a competitor. It happened to be a foreign competitor to that particular organization. So the question would be, are you confident someone hasn't left your organization and taken something with them when they were going to go to work for a competing organization, or to go to set a competing organization, to go to a foreign government, foreign organization? You know, the goal, obviously, from a control standpoint, is to try to prevent your intellectual property from leaving with that individual prior to going to work for an organization. Another example where a former information security director at a lottery association uses a rootkit to alter the random number generator for the lottery system, allowing accomplices to win over $14 million from the lottery system. So think about the first type of incident being someone stealing intellectual property, an insider doing that. The second one would be a system administrator modifying critical systems, critical services, using a tool unauthorized to modify the lottery system. Different types of incidents caused then by an insider, but then those would then be related to different types of preventative or detective controls. And a third example we actually described, a disgruntled contract employee at a wastewater facility treatment facility, a sewage treatment facility, accesses the SCADA systems after termination. You know, was let go from the organization, retained radio control equipment, kept the equipment when he left the organization, went around on multiple occasions and discharged 800,000 liters of raw sewage into the environment. Again, different type of insider incident, different type of impact. Again, what we want to do is walk through a number of different scenarios and present a framework to you where you can certainly try to prevent, detect, and respond to these types of incidents. So if you look at the pervasiveness of insider incidents, we've been doing surveys going back to about 2004. How frequent are insider incidents within organizations? You know, pretty consistently, the blue line that describes up here is the number of organizations that experienced an insider incident in that given year. You know, last year came out at 34%, the year before 43%. So we tend to describe, on average, about 50% of the organizations experience at least one malicious insider incident in the previous year. You know, looking at the ones that were actually committed by insiders, looking at the percentage overall, the types of incidents, you can see the percentage and breakdown as well. And if you were at the keynote on Tuesday, Christopher Young, the CEO of McAfee, stated that 40% of the cyber events from the previous year, which was 2017, were actually attributed to an insider, you know, quoting the statistic from the Verizon data breach report. So on average, we tend to think that about, you know, one out of every two organizations experience an insider incident each year. Are you able to prevent, detect, and or respond to those activities? So what we try to provide as a research organization, so we're a federally funded research and development center. We're not here to sell you a tool or a technology. We're here to do research and transition that knowledge into operational communities. We try to describe a framework by which you can build an insider threat program, or you may call it an insider risk program. But the goal would be to identify people that you bring into the organization. Your insider threat program building should start early on in the life cycle, as you do pre-employment screening, as you do verification and validation of people on the way in the door. We start building the efficacy of the insider threat program. And as individuals progress across their career with the organization, what we tend to describe below the line, those green lines coming down, would be the potential risk indicators that are technically based. The tools and technologies that traditionally are deployed and managed and operated by your IT departments, those tend to be where the potential risk indicators could be coming from a technology standpoint. But what we found early on when we analyzed insider incidents, that there's a significant amount of behaviorally based information that's available well before the technology could be detecting the potential risk indicators of that particular individual. So what we describe above the line would be traditionally the non-technical data sources, considering data sources from human resources or physical security or general counsel or coworker reporting of activity. So the goal of an insider threat program obviously would be to prevent insiders from doing something, but that something shouldn't be preventing them from doing their job, because the majority of insiders aren't acting maliciously against your organization. So what we want to do is present in this framework is a way to identify the potential threats to your critical assets and then try to build a framework by which we can prevent the malicious activity, but still allow an individual to do his or her job. And if something is detected, how do we detect it early enough to minimize the impact? So that's the foundation by which we want to prevent damage from happening, and we want to use this framework opportunity to describe how you can do that effectively within your organization. So the objectives of this presentation will be to identify, select, and develop and implement insider threat controls. You know, some of those controls can be or should be developed by you as an organization, but we do also want you to leverage existing standards and frameworks that are currently out there today. So we will present some of the ones that you can currently implement or you're currently implementing today. We want to give some guidance and advice in navigating the insider threat control landscape. You know, there's significant amount of information that may be valuable to you, but the significant comes with the amount of time and resources needed to kind of wade through that landscape. So what we want to do is present to you kind of a quick win or the quick solutions to implement those effectively. And then finally, once you are able to develop those controls, trying to measure the effectiveness of your insider threat controls. Again, that's where most organizations tend to spend significant amount of time, fine-tuning the controls that are put in place to try to effectively identify the true positives and, to the greatest extent possible, reduce the false positives that are being alerted or generating by the tools that you're deploying. So what we're going to do is present this five-step process by which you can implement and operate the insider threat controls. So we'll start with identifying insider threats to critical assets as step one, then move on to establishing insider threat control baseline as two, then moving into step three being, you know, fill critical gaps in control baseline. So we develop something, analyze the effectiveness of it, and identify any gaps, and then looking in step four to measure the effectiveness of the insider threat controls, and then that feedback loop in step five to continue to improve the process. So this is what we're going to spend the majority of our time today focusing on, these five steps. Okay, so let's start with step number one, identifying insider threats to critical assets. So let's begin by saying that there's a significant difference between insiders and insider threats. And hopefully you're well aware of that unique difference, that you are all insiders to your organization. You're granted authorized access to the facilities, to the information, to the technologies that's being used by your organization. But I assure you that most of you aren't threats to everything in your organization. Again, as we implement preventative controls, detective controls, we're trying to segment authority access to really only give people access to what they need to do their job. So in step one, what we want to walk you through is the process by which you can identify who poses a threat to what in your organization. So if you start to the very left of the diagram, these are the individuals that are granted authorized access to what's most important to you as an organization. Those could be current or former employees. Those could be the full-time, part-time employees, the temporary employees, the contractors, you know, anyone that you give authorized access to. That's your set of insiders starting to the left. And then building this risk matrix, moving from the first to the second box, identifying individuals who have or had authorized access to your organization assets. That's column number two. And again, looking at what we would describe as the components or the categories of critical assets, protection of people, protection of facilities, protection of information, as well as protection of technology. So here and then we start to be able to map the individuals that are granted authorized access to what's most critical to you. And here we start then building as we move into the individuals that have authorized access to what you're trying to prevent, detect, and respond, is the individuals who could, with malicious intent or without malicious intent, cause some type of harm. And what we describe in here are the different types of incidents that we've analyzed. Insiders who have committed fraud, insiders who have stolen intellectual property, insiders who have sabotaged systems, insiders who have committed espionage or workplace violence, social engineering. Whatever those would be, someone with malicious intent or without malicious intent causing some type of harm. And as you can start seeing, now we're able to build a better particular roadmap to prevent that particular type of activity. And you have selective types of controls that might be effective for fraud or sabotage or espionage or workplace violence. Recognizing that insiders could cause cyber harm or physical harm, that there's some cyber attack causes cyber impact, but also cyber attack causing physical impact, or physical attack causing physical, or physical causing a cyber. So again, starting to build this risk matrix goes a long way to identifying which controls may be effective or not. And in the end, looking at how do we prevent certain impacts to the organization. the harm to the employees, organizations, the employees of the organization, or degradation of the CIA, the confidentiality, availability, or integrity, or disruption of services. So in the end, the takeaway from here is that there is not one insider threat type that's applicable to all of your organizations. And as you're looking to build a formality into your insider threat program or insider risk program, you need to really start with protecting what's most important to you. And that's the foundation of developing and implementing these controls to prevent or detect malicious or unintentional insider activity. And then what we want to do is start with, again, going back to identifying the insider threats to your organization. One of the things that we found out a long time ago, we do vulnerability assessments for organizations. We do insider threat program evaluations for organizations. We started way back when, 10 to 12 years ago, going into organizations and asking the question, what's most critical to you? Again, that's usually the foundation of identifying critical assets, most important to you. But what we found early on is that depending upon who you ask in an organization, what's important to them might be different from what's important to other people in the organization, and it may not tie to the mission of the organization. You know, in terms of self-preservation in organizations, I'm going to do what I need to do to assure my job is completed to the greatest extent possible, the greatest practical extent. But again, how that relates to the mission of the organization is where we saw some of the differences between what's most important to an individual and what's most important to the organization. So the way we start any of our vulnerability assessments is we start by asking the question, what is the mission of your organization? And then breaking that down into the critical services that support the mission, and then breaking those down into the business processes that need to be in operation to allow that particular critical service to fulfill the mission of the organization. And if any of those critical services are disrupted, any of those business processes are disrupted, the organization wouldn't be able to achieve its particular mission. And then what you can do is focus on below the business processes, well, who are the people that support the business processes? What is the information that's needed? What is the technology that's needed? What are the facilities that are needed? And then we can start building specifically what are the critical assets that support that business process to support that critical service that supports the mission of the organization. So again, depending upon who you ask, it should tie to the fulfillment and mission of the organization. In all cases, what you want to do for each of those assets is to be able to protect them, but also sustain them. Again, those could be from external threats, but also internal threats as well. And then one thing that I heard yesterday in one of the keynotes is when you start looking at the critical assets, most organizations do a great job at categorizing critical assets by the type of systems, the number of systems. They have asset control list of here are all of our workstations, here's all of our servers, here's all of our laptops, here's all of our movable devices. But I heard yesterday the suggestion in one of the keynotes that do you have some type of information custodian that actually tracks the information on those particular machines, those devices, those laptops as well. Again, if you're trying to protect the information, it does need to be the information, which we describe as the information here, which could be similar, but also different from the types of technologies as well. So when we're looking at organization assets, we want to get the right people involved early on. That does include enterprise-wide risk management, the business process owners, executive teams, the board of directors, really looking to prioritize the threats relative to the potential impacts. Obviously, you want to build resiliency into your mission-critical systems and services. You know, that starts by looking at what are the critical assets, and if compromised, which could not allow us to impact the or fulfill the mission of the organization itself. So as we move on from step one to step two, we want to establish the insider threat control baseline. So we start with identifying the critical assets. Now here's the control baseline. So steps to success, as we would identify those, figure out what you need. Look at existing standards today. And we'll give you an example of NIST 853 as a framework by which you can start with some of the controls that are recommended there. You're looking at the traditional cybersecurity controls. They do provide that solid foundation. But really looking at the technical, the physical, as well as the administrative controls. There needs to be a defense in depth in relation to the controls that you would put forward. And really engage other key parts of your organization. So the chart that you see here, the control areas by stakeholders, is the foundation by which we do insider threat vulnerability assessments. We look at the data owners and look for ways that they can assist in prevention or detection of insider threats along the asset categories that are up here. We also have human resources being involved in insider threat mitigation. the control areas that they would be responsible for, including recruitment, the policies, procedures, et cetera. Information technology has control areas as well, access control, really looking at modification or deletion or disruption of services as their responsibilities. General counsel or legal, think about the controls that they can be put in place to include the agreements to protect things like sensitive information, really restriction of outside employment or the employee behaviors in the workplace. Physical security will have administrative, technical, and other controls as well as software engineering. And what we mean by software engineering will be if you develop your own software, are you implementing security controls in place that would prevent or detect insider threats from modifying those particular critical systems or service or software in relation to the organization mission? So again, we have a lot of this published on our website. Again, the slides will be available, so feel free to ask us questions when we get to the Q&A portion. But when you develop the controls, think about six different categories of control functions. Think about the preventative controls, the controls that would prevent unintentional or intentional harm to organizations. Example might be something that would prohibit authorized or unauthorized or connections, maybe the technical firewalls, the physical locks or controls. Then moving down to the detective controls, again, detective will be looking for and identifying and reporting unauthorized suspicious activity. Then the corrective controls, again, controls that would respond and fix a security concern. Maybe if you have virus controls that are put in place, virus identification, but also virus remediation would tend to fall under the corrective controls. And the recovery controls in the fourth category that's defined here, really the recovery is really looking to restore the operations after an incident. If someone does happen to steal your data, are you able to get it back? Maybe an example of the recovery controls. Deter controls, really the ways you're discouraging security violations. Again, these tend to be more of the deterrence, security cameras, other types of controls, putting up signage in your organization, maybe some of the monitoring policies that are known to the employees of your organization. And then finally, the compensating controls, really when you're looking to develop some alternatives to the recommended or normal controls. So for example, let's say that you have a server that's up and running, but you're not able to deploy the antivirus on it because it might interact or interfere with whatever that critical application is. You may want to implement some enhanced monitoring to compensate for the inability to put that type of monitoring system and the server and the virus checking software on it as well. Okay, so what also we want to do is point you in the direction of NIST 853. This is security and privacy controls for federal and federal information systems and organizations. It talks about a number of control families, a number of control areas. And we're very fortunate to have worked with NIST back a few years ago on Rev 4 to actually implement some of the insider threat controls in it. So if you look at some of the ones that are identified here, there are controls related to incident response, controls related to media protection, controls related to physical and environmental protection, physical security, systems and communication protection, system and information and integrity. Again, we just try to provide some of the examples that might be effective from an insider threat perspective. Also moving into some of the program management controls, access controls, as well as security awareness and training controls, some of the security assessment and authorization, contingency planning, as well as identification and authorization. So in all of the ones that we list up here, there is some impact where they might be effective from any of those number of six layers of controls that we talked about in the previous slide. And also, as you're looking from a tool perspective, we would certainly recommend a tool to be part of your insider threat program, but it shouldn't be the soul of your program. Recognizing that on the exhibitor floor today in the South or the North Halls, we've counted about 110 solution providers to insider threats. We want to provide guidance to you in relation to the type of tools that may be effective. So if you look at the user activity monitoring solutions, there's a particular benefit for using UAM type tools, but also looking at data loss prevention that would be effective to prevent data, obviously, from leaving the organization. But also the SIEM, S-I-E-M tools, security and information event management tools, we'd recommend considering those as well as the analytic type tools that might be available, and finally the forensics. So again, tools should be a significant component of your program, but a tool is not your program in isolation. And then finally, don't overlook the administrative controls as well. Again, these really help from a deterrent perspective, really focusing on the policies, the procedures, really documenting what is considered normal or acceptable behavior within an organization. So some exemplars of the controls that you most likely have in place, maybe the IT acceptable use policy, the IP policy that's put in place, the data handling, controlling policies, incident response plan, bringing people in through onboarding, but also separation policies as well. These administrative controls can go a long way to supplement the technical controls you're putting in place to prevent, detect, or deter individuals as well. So with that, I'll turn it over to Dan to go through the remaining components of that framework we're going to walk through, starting with selecting and implementing the insider threat controls.
Thanks, Randy. So we got a really good overview of the breadth of the different threat scenarios that comprise insider incidents. You got a good overview of the breadth of available controls and the different control functions that they play. Randy talked about the presence of dozens and dozens of tools that are out there to help you solve some portion of this problem. The next question is, how do we know what we need? And how do we know what the right tool for the job is? So what we have identified as being a best practice is by starting to be really smart about thinking about your threat scenarios. What part of that problem are you trying to carve off and address? What part of that overall kind of concept of insider risk are you trying to mitigate to some extent? Start by thinking about your threat scenarios. What applicable threat scenarios are you trying to address or control? Break those threat scenarios down into their component parts, and we've got a couple of models that we can point you in the direction of to help you get started here. Map those model components to the observable events or activities that comprise that threat scenario. So that threat scenario, what does it look like? What happens before the bad thing occurs? What are the opportunities to detect and respond to precursor activities before the negative event occurs? And mapping those observables to controls. So we'll walk you through an example of this using one of the models that we've put together over years of collecting and analyzing insider incident data. So this particular model talks about patterns that we've seen in cases involving IT system sabotage. We've got models like this for fraud that are available on our website. We've also got models like this that are available for theft of intellectual property. But we'll go through this example of our IT system sabotage model very quickly, break this model down into its component parts, identify the observables, and show you how to map controls to those observables. So what we've seen, our IT system sabotage cases start with personal predispositions, things about individuals, their patterns of behavior and activity, their personality characteristics. Different people have different personal predispositions. Those personal predispositions include things like expectations around things like workload or recognition or compensation or benefits or relationships between coworkers and relationships between how the individual feels supported by the organization. As things happen relative to an individual working within an organization, those expectations are met or unmet. And unmet expectations, things like being passed over for a promotion, things like getting into conflicts with supervisors or coworkers, can potentially lead to individuals becoming disgruntled. Disgruntlement manifests itself in individuals, primarily based on the data that we've studied, first through the exhibition of behavioral precursors. These include things like declines in performance or attendance at work, increased anger at work. Okay? Those behavioral precursors could be potentially discovered by the organization based on what behavioral monitoring mechanisms they have in place. And in many cases, we've seen organizations take sanctions against individuals who are exhibiting behavioral precursors that were indicative of their disgruntlement. Those sanctions can include things like suspensions, demotions, terminations. And those sanctions then could lead to increased levels of disgruntlement. And at a certain point, there's a tipping point where an individual decides to take some action against the organization, motivated primarily by revenge in cases of IT system sabotage, to correct what they've seen as an injustice done to them. Then we're starting to talk about being able to identify technical precursors, setting up themselves to be able to carry out some attack, making it harder for the organization to be able to identify or attribute that attack back to that individual. Those technical precursors include things like creating backdoor, shared, unattributable accounts, disabling or attempting to disable security controls, really making it harder for the organization to understand that A, something bad happened, and B, making it harder for them to understand who did it. The organization's ability to understand and identify those technical precursors, obviously, is made manifest by what technical monitoring capabilities they have in place. Your ability to detect those technical precursor activities then makes it more or less likely that you have an understanding of a bad thing occurring or a bad thing about to occur. Gaps in technical and behavioral monitoring lead an organization to overtrust an individual by continuing to give them authorized access to resources that they may be potentially misusing without being able to know that this person is setting up to commit an attack, without having an adequate level of technical and behavioral monitoring. We call that a trust trap. So there's a difference then in the actual risk of that insider attack and what the organization perceives as the risk of insider attack due to an insufficient level of insider threat controls. So that's IT system sabotage and our model for it. Let's break that down into its component parts. We start to take each of those model components. Those are really types or heuristics that we're using to describe a collection of actual observables, things that you can look for, conditions you can look for in the data sources that your organization collects and potentially can analyze to be able to say something about the absence or presence of those behaviors and activities to give you a chance to better respond to those before a damaging incident occurs. So we've gone through the personal predispositions. We talked about the unmet expectations. We've talked about the technical precursors. When you look at those concealment activities, again, going back to being able to not attribute an event back to an individual. And when we talk about the crime script, the things that kind of comprise IT system sabotage cases, we're talking about modifying or deleting critical data, or configurations of critical systems as a way to make them unavailable, right? We're talking about ways to deny service to critical systems and applications that cost the organization money. Again, motivated by revenge, technically proficient individuals who have a significant amount of disgruntlement, have manifested themselves motivated to carry out an attack based on some collection of perceived injustices that have been done to them. These are the things that we've seen them do. Physical attack to equipment and inserting malicious code into systems. So these are the observables that are underneath kind of each of those little model components that are in our IT system sabotage model. Now that we've enumerated and identified the things that we can look for, we can start to think about the associated controls that can help us, A, detect that concerning behavior or activity, B, deter that activity from occurring in the first place, C, prevent that activity from occurring, respond to that event or activity happening, right? Going back to our cybersecurity control functions. So what we can then do is, now that we've got that model broken down into its observables, we can start to think about what controls we can apply and what control functions we want to apply relative to those. Do we want to spend time preventing an unmet expectation from happening? Or do we really want to spend our time focusing on just knowing when that unmet expectation has occurred, right? Really going deep into understanding the different control functions and the opportunities to deploy controls based on those control functions for where we're at relative to the crime script. When you start to think about the personal predispositions and the stressors, you'll typically see organizations select detective controls, right? It's more important to be able to know that those behaviors are happening that are of concern than it is to try to be able to prevent them from happening. As you start to continue to move down, you get closer to the crime script, you'll see opportunities for preventative controls. You'll see opportunities to be able to stop someone from creating some backdoor unattributable account. You'll see opportunities for being able to prevent somebody from creating some malicious code and inserting that into a production system. So as you continue to kind of progress towards the path of the crime script, you've got opportunities now to start to layer on top those preventative controls, deterrent controls. And obviously, near the crime script, if you've not been able to get left of boom, you need to start thinking about your responsive controls, right? How do we recover from that malicious code being inserted to the system? What policies, procedures are in place? What capabilities are in place? This is an example of how to take a model, break it down into its component parts, and then at that individual observable level, start to think about the controls that you can apply across those different control functions to mitigate risk. Another key aspect of this is based on the control selection decisions you've made and you've rolled out, after being smart about breaking your actual needs and requirements down into its component parts and mapping those to controls, how do we know that these controls are working? How do we know what we've selected and implemented based on all of the different controls we showed you and all the different tools we showed you? How do we know that we've got a good solution in place? There are several degrees and dimensions where we've seen organizations measure the effectiveness of their insider threat controls. If we're talking about detective controls, it's easy to start to focus on coverage. So what percentage of those events that are happening across the organization do we have insight into? You can think about things like endpoint monitoring solutions and the ability to kind of gain access into what's happening kind of on the endpoints. Back at the enterprise level, what percentage of those endpoints across the organization do we have the ability to see? What percentage of the concerning behaviors and activity do we have a data source that's able to help us gain some insight and understanding into when it's occurring across the organization? Another thing that we'll see very often deployed is true and false positive rates for detective controls. Right? So we have some mechanism by which we're collecting data and analyzing data to say, we think that that observable happened. In many cases, we're talking about things that are probabilistic. It's not a binary yes or no operation. So then you're talking about being able to measure whether or not every time an alert was generated that says that we think a backdoor unattributable account was created, that either did or didn't occur. And we have to measure the effectiveness of that detective control relative to ground truth, relative to what actually happened. And it's really important when we're starting to talk about true and false positive rates for insider threat controls to understand a couple of things. There's a really key difference between a faulty defective control and a bad insider threat indicator, right? So measuring true and false positives kind of operates on two dimensions for insider threat controls. One, we're talking about essentially the ability to identify a particular observable. And really, we're talking about the mechanics of how we're collecting and analyzing that data. There's another way that we need to start to think about measuring the effectiveness of our controls. We're starting to think about whether or not that condition is actually a good indicator of potential insider risk. Right? The best indicator of insider risk would be something that happened every time an insider incident was about to occur or had occurred and never happened any other time. Those silver bullet indicators don't exist. Okay? What we see organizations struggle with is figuring out which of those two scenarios they're actually measuring when they're describing the true or false positive rates of their detective controls. So it's really important to understand the difference between a bad detective control and a bad insider indicator. Finally, we'll wrap with measures of effectiveness to talk about the impact. What's the impact that deploying that set of controls has had across the organization? Are we talking about being able to characterize the number of malicious actions that were prevented? Can we characterize the number of documents that were stopped from leaving some authorized location relative to the organization? And what the financial impact of that kind of data leak would have been had that piece of information left? We can also start to think about reduced latencies in processes involving incident response, investigations. Have we made it easier for the organization to make better risk-based decisions by giving them new views of data that were collected from disparate sources across the organization? Now, through the Insider Threat Program, we have the ability to collect, correlate, analyze, and give that information back out to the stakeholders in an effective and efficient process. So how do we get at some of those measures of effectiveness? How do we start to test these things? Tabletops. Start with leveraging existing testing scenarios for cybersecurity controls. Lots of organizations run tabletop exercises to kind of measure how the SOC is going to do in response to event X or Y or Z. Work insider threat scenarios into those tabletop exercises. This will give you a chance to exercise your stakeholders' abilities to execute on those insider threat policies and procedures and identify those critical gaps. One of the things that we've seen is as organizations start to work insider threat scenarios into those tabletops, you'll start to identify edge cases. So what happens if an event is potentially attributed to somebody within the C-suite of the organization? That's something that kind of starts to involve different parts of insider threat incident response that aren't typically exercised in your normal SOC tabletop exercise. Penetration testing is another great way to test insider threat controls. It gives the organization ability to test those controls abilities to identify that malicious data from the benign data and measure the controls abilities to prevent, detect, and respond to technically sophisticated attacks. Right? So as your penetration tests are happening, consider insider threat scenarios, right? So let the pen tester start with authorized access and see what they can do in terms of laterally moving across the IT infrastructure and ways to avoid detection, right? Ask the pen testers to put on their insider threat black hats. More advanced techniques can start to get into the mod sim space. You start to think about inserting synthetic threat data, right? So instead of having an actual attack occur and waiting for that to be the way that we'll kind of measure the effectiveness of the controls, you can set up scenarios where you insert synthetic threat data into operational data sets and measure your controls' ability to differentiate that tagged known synthetic data from that benign activity. And there's another technique that's out there that's been developed by Frank Reitzer and his team that talks about measuring predictive models against known insider incident data. So lots of different ways to measure the effectiveness of insider threat controls. And finally, it's important to remember that these control selection and identification activities aren't one-shots. They don't happen one time within an organization, and then that's that. The threat landscape changes relative to an organization as new disruptive technologies come online. Organization-level events change the threat landscape and the vulnerabilities that an organization is susceptible to. We've seen things like mergers, acquisitions, large reductions in force drastically change the threat scenario for an organization. Now we're talking about lots of people being exposed to stressors that could potentially lead to them to cause disgruntlement or lead to them to exhibit disgruntlement, right? So the threat landscape for the organization is dynamic. Current events, the workforce changes. As millennials enter the workforce, right? How does the personal predispositions and stressors of those individuals vary from preceding generations? So the threat landscape is dynamic even from an insider threat perspective. And your organization's appetite for risk changes, right? This is why it's so important to have the right people involved so that you can make sure that your controls stay aligned with the priorities of the organization. What risks are most critical to the people that have the right answers across the organization? And stuff breaks. Insider threat programs and insider threat controls collect data from lots of different sources. There's lots that goes into kind of the implementation and operation of a large insider threat data collection and aggregation capability. So it's important for organizations to implement periodic reassessments of the highest priority incidents to the organization and how the insider threat control space aligns to that, to periodically measure the effectiveness of those insider threat controls, utilizing the testing techniques that we described before, and improving those controls based on lessons learned from those test exercises. So as you start to bring this one home and head towards question and answers, it's important to remember that insider threat controls should be driven by an enterprise-wide effort to identify the highest priority items, the highest priority risk areas to the organization. Use those highest priority risks to start to identify those threat scenarios that associate with those highest priority risks. Break those threat scenarios down into their component parts, into those observables, the things that you can collect and analyze data on. Use those observables to help you drive towards selecting insider threat controls that serve a bunch of different functions, and then being cognizant of the fact that your threat landscape changes and it's important to deploy measures of effectiveness and have a process that's responsive to the output of those measures of effectiveness. So as you start to think about how to apply what we've talked about today, ask yourself these questions. Does our organization have a prioritized list of its critical assets? And was it put together based on the input of the right stakeholders? Or was it put together based on a couple of folks buried way down the org chart, just taking a swag at it. Map those threats that insiders pose to your critical assets, assuming that that critical asset list is enumerated, and start to think about what controls are already in place. And past that, you formalize kind of that thought process relative to establishing that insider threat control baseline. Enumerating those threat scenarios that you have coverage gaps across, breaking those down into their observable components, and starting to use that thought process to help drive insider threat control selection decisions. So with that, we'll pause for questions, and we'll put our contact information up. As Randy mentioned, we have over 125 publications available on our website. Please check us out at cert.org/insider-threat.
And certainly, if we're getting close to the end of our time, we'd be happy to take questions offline outside of the session here. Or as I mentioned, we do have a booth 1538 on the South Moscone Center, so feel free to stop there. I will be there from 10 to 12 today. And certainly feel free to reach out to us through the email that's up here, or as Dan said, through our website. Thanks very much for your kind attention and getting here so early this morning. Thank you.
I have one question. So how much, if you go back to the example where you had the flowchart, how much of that is based on data, global data survey? Do you have data survey or analysis of this?
Yeah, so the model that Dan presented is IT sabotage. I believe we have
The sabotage. How much of that has data backing?
We have about 200 cases that built that model. Uh-huh. So it's all empirically based upon actual incidents that have occurred. All the models that you find on our website are based upon actual incidents that have occurred.
Is it globally or regional?
So the majority of our cases are domestic, United States. We do have some cases globally. But yes, most of them are United States cases. Good question. Oh, hi there.